Harper Audio presents Warriors, Number 6, The Darkest Hour, by Erin Hunter. Performed by MacLeod Andrews. Prologue. Rain fell steadily, drumming on the hard black thunderpath that led between unending rows of stone two-leg nests. From time to time, a monster snarled past, its eyes glaring, and a single two-leg scurried along, huddled into its shiny pelt. Two cats slipped silently around the corner, keeping close to the walls where the shadows were deepest. A skinny gray tom with a ragged ear and bright watchful eyes went first, every hair on his body slicked dark with the wet. Behind him prowled a huge tabby with massive shoulders and muscles that slid smoothly under his rain-soaked pelt. His amber eyes glowed in the harsh light, and his gaze shifted back and forth as if he expected an attack. He paused where the dark entrance to a two-leg nest offered a little shelter and growled,
"How much farther? This place stinks."
The gray tom glanced back.
"Not far now."
"It had better not be."
Grimacing, the dark brown tabby padded on, ears twitching irritably to flick away the raindrops. Harsh yellow light angled across him, and he flinched as a monster roared around the corner, throwing up a wave of filthy water that reeked of two-leg rubbish. The cat let out a snarl as the water slopped around his paws and the spray drizzled down on his fur. Everything about the two-leg place disgusted him. The hard surface under his paws, the stench of monsters and the two legs they carried in their bellies, the unfamiliar noises, and most of all, the way he could not survive here without a guide. The tabby was not used to depending on another cat for anything. In the forest, he knew every tree, every stream, every rabbit hole. He was considered the strongest and most dangerous warrior in all the clans. Now his sharpened skills and senses were useless. He felt as if he were deaf, blind, and lame, reduced to following his companion like a kit trailing helplessly after its mother. But it would be worth it. The tabby's whiskers twitched in anticipation. He had already launched a plan that would turn his most hated enemies into helpless prey in their own territory. When the dogs attacked, no cat would suspect that they had been lured and guided every step of the way. And then, if things went according to plan, his expedition into Two-Leg Place would give him all he had ever wanted. The gray cat led the way along the path and across an open space reeking of two-leg monsters, where a swirl of color from unnatural orange light floated on the puddles. He stopped by the entrance to a narrow alley and opened his jaws to draw in the scent of the air. The tabby halted and did the same, disgustedly swiping his tongue over his lips at the stink of rotting two-leg food.
"Is this the place?" he asked.
"This is it,"
the gray warrior replied tensely.
"Now remember what I told you. The cat we're going to meet holds command over many cats. We must treat him with respect."
"Boulder, have you forgotten who I am?"
The tabby took a step forward so that he towered over his companion. The skinny gray cat's ears flattened.
"No, Tigerstar, I haven't forgotten. But you're not clan leader here."
Tigerstar grunted.
"Let's get on with it," he growled.
Boulder turned into the alley. He stopped short after just a few paces when a huge shape loomed up in front of them.
"Who goes there?"
A broad-shouldered black and white cat stepped out of the shadows. Strong muscles were outlined under fur plastered to his body by the rain.
"Identify yourselves. We don't like strangers here."
"Greetings, Bone,"
the gray warrior meowed steadily.
"Remember me?"
The black and white cat narrowed his eyes and was silent for a few moments.
"So you've come back, have you, Boulder?"
he meowed at last.
"You told us you were going to find a better life in the forest. What are you doing here?"
He took a step forward, but Boulder held his ground, unsheathing his claws against the uneven ground.
"We want to see Scourge."
Bone let out a snort, half contempt, half laughter.
"I can't imagine that Scourge will want to see you. And who's this with you? I don't recognize him."
"My name is Tigerstar.
I've come from the forest to speak with your leader.
Bone's green eyes flicked from Tigerstar to Boulder and back again.
What do you want with him?
He demanded. Tigerstar's amber gaze burned like the two-legged lights reflected on the shining wet stones around them.
I'll discuss that with your leader, not his border patrol.
Bone bristled and extended his claws, but Boulder quickly slipped between him and Tigerstar.
Scourge needs to hear this, he insisted. It could be to every cat's advantage.
For a few heartbeats, Bone hesitated, and then he stepped back, allowing Boulder and Tigerstar to pass. His hostile glare scorched their fur, but he said nothing. Now Tigerstar took the lead, treading cautiously as the light faded behind them. On either side, skinny cats were slinking behind piles of rubbish, eyes gleaming as they followed the progress of the two intruders. Tigerstar's muscles tensed. If this meeting went wrong, he might have to fight his way out. A wall blocked the end of the alley. Tigerstar stared around, looking for the leader of these cats of two-legged place. He was expecting an even more massive creature than the broad-shouldered Bone, and at first his gaze swept over the small black cat crouching in a shadowy doorway. Boulder gave him a nudge and jerked his head in the black cat's direction.
There's Scourge. That's Scourge?
Tigerstar's exclamation rang with disbelief above the falling rain.
He's no bigger than an apprentice.
Shh!
Panic flared in Boulder's eyes.
This may not be a clan as we know it, but these cats would kill if their leader ordered them to. It seems I have visitors.
The black cat's voice had a brittle, high-pitched sound, like the splintering of ice.
I wasn't expecting to see you again, Boulder. I heard you'd gone to live in the forest.
Yes, Scourge, I have, Boulder replied.
So what are you doing here?
Scourge's voice held the faintest suggestion of a snarl.
Have you changed your mind and come crawling back? Do you expect me to welcome you?
No, Scourge.
Boulder held the black cat's ice-blue gaze.
It's a good life in the forest. There is plenty of fresh kill, no two legs.
You haven't come to extol the virtues of forest life.
Scourge interrupted him with a flick of his tail.
Squirrels live in trees, not cats.
His eyes narrowed, glinting with a pale fire.
So what do you want?
Tigerstar stepped forward, shouldering the gray warrior aside.
I am Tigerstar, the leader of Shadow Clan, he growled. And I have a proposition for you.
Chapter 1 Watery shafts of light sliced through the bare trees as Fireheart carried his leader to her final resting place. With his teeth clenched firmly in her scruff, he retraced the route the dog pack had taken as the brave warrior of ThunderClan lured them to the gorge and their destruction. His whole body felt numb, and his head spun with the terrible realization that Blue Star was dead. Without his leader, the forest itself seemed different, even stranger to Fireheart than the day he had first ventured into it as a kitty pet. Nothing was real. He felt as if the trees and rocks could dissolve like mist within a moment. A vast, unnatural silence covered everything. With the rational part of his mind, Fireheart realized that all the prey had been scared away by the rampaging dog pack. But in the grip of his grief, it seemed that even the forest was stunned into mourning for Blue Star. The scene at the gorge replayed over and over in his head. He saw again the slavering jaws of the dog who led the pack, and felt its sharp teeth meet in his scruff. He remembered how Blue Star had appeared out of nowhere, flinging herself at the dog, driving it and herself over the edge of the gorge and into the river. He flinched again at the icy shock of the water as he leaped in to rescue his drowning leader and their hopeless struggles until two River Clan warriors, Mistyfoot and Stonefur, came to help them. Most of all, Fireheart recalled his dismay and disbelief as he crouched beside his leader on the riverbank and realized that she had sacrificed her last life to save him and all of ThunderClan from the dog pack. As he bore Blue Star's body home with the help of Mistyfoot and Stonefur, he kept pausing to scent the air for fresh traces of dog, and he had already sent his friend Graystripe to scout the territory on either side of their trail, searching for signs that the dogs had caught any of the ThunderClan cats in their desperate race for the gorge. So far, to Fireheart's relief, they had found nothing. Now, skirting a bramble thicket, Fireheart set down his lifeless leader once more and raised his head to drink in the air, thankful to taste only the clean scents of the forest. A moment later, Graystripe appeared around a clump of dead bracken.
"Everything's fine, Fireheart," he reported. "Plenty of broken undergrowth, but that's all."
"Good," Fireheart meowed. His hope rose that the dogs that had escaped the fall into the gorge had fled in terror, and the forest once again belonged to the four clans of wildcats. His clan had lived through three terrible moons, when they had become prey in their own territory, but they had survived.
"Let's keep going. I want to check that the camp is safe before the clan comes back."
He and the River Clan warriors took up Blue Star's body again and carried it through the trees.
At the top of the ravine that led down to the camp entrance, Fireheart paused.
He briefly remembered the early morning, when he and his warriors had followed the trail of dead rabbits that Tigerstar had laid to lure the dog pack to the ThunderClan camp. At the end of the trail, they had found the body of the gentle Queen Brindleface, slaughtered to give the savage dogs a taste for cat blood. But now everything seemed peaceful. And when Fireheart tasted the air again, he could detect only cat scent coming from the camp.
"Wait here," he meowed. "I'm going to take a look."
"I'll come with you,"
Graystripe offered instantly.
"No."
It was Stonefur who spoke, flicking out his tail to bar the gray warrior's way.
"I think Fireheart needs to do this alone."
Flashing a grateful look at the RiverClan deputy, Fireheart began picking his way down the ravine, his ears pricked for any sound of trouble ahead. But the strange silence still reigned over the forest. As he emerged from the gorse tunnel into the clearing, Fireheart paused to glance warily around. It was possible that one or more of the dogs had never made it to the gorge, or that Tigerstar had sent ShadowClan warriors to take over the camp. But all was quiet. Fireheart's fur prickled with the strangeness of seeing the camp deserted like this. Yet there was no sign of danger, and still no scent of dogs or ShadowClan. To be sure the camp was safe, he rapidly checked the dens and the nursery. Memories came unbidden. The bewilderment of the clan as he told them about the dog pack. The heart-pounding terror of the chase through the forest with the breath of the pack leader hot on his fur. At the foot of the high rock, listening to the wind whispering through the trees, Fireheart thought back to the time Tigerstar had stood here, boldly facing his clan as they discovered the true depth of his treachery. He had sworn undying vengeance as he was sent into exile, and Fireheart was sure that his bloodthirsty attempt to set the dog pack on the cats of ThunderClan would not be his last attempt to fulfill his oath. Last of all, Fireheart prowled cautiously through the fern tunnel to Cinderpelt's den. Glancing through the entrance, he saw the medicine cat's healing herbs neatly ranged beside one wall. The strongest memory yet flooded over him, of Spotted Leaf and Yellowfang, who had been ThunderClan medicine cats before Cinderpelt. Fireheart had loved them both, and grief for them swept over him again to mingle with his grief for his leader.
"Blue Star is dead," he told them silently. "Is she with you now, in StarClan?"
Retracing his steps along the fern tunnel, he returned to the top of the ravine. Graystripe was standing on watch while Mistyfoot and Stonefur gently groomed the dead leader's body.
"Everything's fine," Fireheart announced. "Graystripe, I want you to go to Sunning Rocks now. Tell the clan that Blue Star is dead, but nothing more. I'll explain everything when I see them. Just let them know that it's safe to come home."
Graystripe's yellow eyes brightened.
"On my way, Fireheart."
He spun around and tore off through the forest, heading for Sunning Rocks, where the clan had gone to hide while the dogs were following Tigerstar's trail of rabbit blood to their camp. Stonefur, crouching beside Blue Star's body, let out a purr of amusement.
"It's easy to see where Graystripe's loyalties lie," he remarked.
"Yes,"
Mistyfoot agreed.
No cat ever really thought he would stay in RiverClan.
Graystripe's kits had been born to a RiverClan queen, and for a while, he had gone to RiverClan to be with them. But in his heart, he had never left ThunderClan. Forced into battle against his birth clan, he had chosen to save Fireheart's life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.